Hey, that's how that works. Okay, how do I turn it back off?
The executive coordinator of the Center for Education and Training for Race and Gender in Public. Professor Hayes is also teaching at the University, and she has been on an extended tour of California universities. She was at UC Santa Barbara, where she had a discussion with Angela Davis, and she was also at Stanford University, gave two or three talks at Santa Barbara, she gave a talk at Stanford, and then she was at Berkeley, and this is her last stop of her California tour, and so what we've decided to do is, Professor Hayes, is she will present some of her own material and the work she's been doing. And after that, we'll have more of a structured dialogue where you can ask questions, but we'd like you to write down the questions and turn them into Rita. And we'll have, and I have some questions too, and we'll structure her talk more on these on the questions. But I won't go into more detail, but Professor Hayes is very, I worked in Brazil until 2000, and I heard about Vilma Reis. She's in the last 5 years, she's coming to her own as a leader in the black movement and women's black movement in Brazil, and on issues of policing and security.
Thank you. So, is that staying here? Hi. It's all right. Good afternoon, eh?
Yeah.
Bom dia. First, I want to say thank you for Professor Edward Ellis and Professor Mark Sawyer to invite me to come here. And all these people that it's really interesting, the debate about the institutional racism baguettes, especially the police brutality in Brazil. That's the issue that I want to talk today. I'm from programs, it's CEAFRO, and CEAFRO, it's a program with 23 black females in Salvador. We have this program for 10 years inside the CEAL, it's the Center for Afro and the Asian Studies in Salvador at the Federal University of Bahia. And from 2004 until 2007, I'm the coordinator. But the other side, I have my resort. It's about police extermination of young black men in Salvador, Bahia. It's the subject that I spent so 8 years, so the last 8 years to doing this work, and I think it's we can do many connections with the resource that we have here. I'm gonna read a piece and then we can talk. The month of May seems to spawn.
I'm gonna be a little. Maybe sometimes you can help me understand.
Okay. I just want to. It's been so just.
Okay.
Just two paragraphs. Thank you. The month of May seems to spell recurring nightmares for the black people of Brazil. this year, 25,000. The months didn't go by without continuing the tradition of opening collective wounds. May it's a time associated with violent deaths. May funeral mark this moment in what we refer to as the Brazilian Civil War, materializing in the daily practices of a police force that is sectarian, warlike, and hyper-nationalistic, treating the black population like internal enemies marked for extermination. The majority of the victims of lethal police force in Brazil are young black men between the age 15 and 24 years, with no previous convictions and residents of the low-income neighborhoods of the city. It's important to talk about previous convictions because having a previous criminal record, it's a sin as a reason to be killed due to the fact that the black population has not had equal access to proposed defense. In the last 3 years, I'm trying to understand why the police from my city, Salvador, in the northeast Brazil, send 22 members from the, so really the Apple policeman command to New York to be training with William Breton and this group that defend zero tolerance and use the race profiling to organize the security, the public security in Brazil. In that way, I have interviewed so many of these people that is in the control of the police in Salvador. It's very important because Salvador is a city, it's the second black city in the world. Yeah? We have 82% of the city is black. And in this context, we have race profiling. And also, when they use the technical professional arguments to, in the same way, have the colorblind politics. Okay? And I think it's the way that I say this, the social democratic function of the new liberal state in Brazil is markedly absent in the black neighborhoods of Salvador. There exists no productive or redistributive social policies, health, education, or job creation programs. Nevertheless, the repressive apparatus of the state has increased in grip and intensified its degree of authoritarian, paramilitarized impunity. In this paper, I analyze police death squad in Brazil as a key dimension of promoting racism embedded in today's new liberal state. Police racism is essential to protecting the unjust privilege of new colonial elites. Police racism is the related production of crime hysteria functions to justify the extension of repressive, segregating policies with simultaneously justifying absolute. It is a grand disgrace for the social citizenship and survival claims of the black population and of no elite people in general. I will also analyze how gender, youth, and masculinity crises are essential dimensions of institutional racism and death brutality in the police sector in Brazil. Finally, I will show how national and urban social movements and leaders have articulated new forms of resistance to police militarism and racism. Just to finish, it's here in the second page, the research study. The research study conducted in Salvador about policies of public safety. With a sure shot, it's a lethal shot in the neck, in the back of the neck, or in the forehead, head, lethal disposal of a campo de desova. That means an isolated area far away from their neighborhoods, preferably without any identification, as not to be immediately identified by family members. They search for a young man that is not involved in criminal activities, who takes class at night and during the day works to help out this family between the age of 15 and 24. This is the way that the young black men, I use this young black man with hyphen, did you say?
Hyphen.
For me, that represents just one. It's a intersection. It's a race, gender, and generation together. I work together because it's the way to understand also the position of class of these people. This is the way that young black men in Salvador appear in the media, humiliated in the reports and the styles of the authorities that should prevent diseases, deaths, and the pain felt by the families that seek to bury their loved ones. This research study conducted in Bahia during the 19 years, is between 1991 and 2001. During this time, specifically from in the second part of the 19 years, really this group from Bahia that visit New York and be training by this global model that the New York really transports to international sphere. My argument is they just use the media, the local media, to show that they have something news, but it's not news because they have no, they just use the zero tolerance model and say we have a project that's called citizen police program in Salvador that they developed close to the university, but everything goes just to continue the rules, the new slavery rules that they have in the city to control the people, and the criminalization of the black young men in the city. When we try to understand what they change exactly when they use the media to say that I have a new model that I get from New York. In truth, they have no new models, they use the name, but they continue the model that they have from the 19th century in Brazil. During the 20th century in Brazil, that is the repression against the black population. Okay? And for women, that means the aspect of the repression was against Candomblé, the Afro-Brazilian religion. So this is the Marxist is very strong, and against black men is the disaction of the police. Before was against capoeira, against samba, against every expression of black people that was on the street. And now we have this stuff of control of the population that we call, really, it's another kind of civil war against half of the country. The black population in Brazil, in the last census, we represent 54.3% of the country. That means 8 million people. That is the second population in the world. The first is in Nigeria, and the second is in Brazil. And they know they have no public policies for these people, and they have to control. And the way to control is use the criminalization. Yeah? But and we have this Cici Nina Rodriguez, this guy that was a member of the school from Lombroso. Do you say Lombroso?
Criminologist.
Yeah, criminologist, yeah, from Italy. And the medical and law school in Brazil was really controlled by this ideology. Yeah? And until today, we need to change this way of how we can have another kind of security without that. But I'm going to start.
I said criminologist, but he measured people's brain capacity physically.
Right, he
so was one of these.
He
was phrenologist.
Yeah, phrenologist. Yeah. Since this time, it was 1890. Yeah. He was in Bahia, in the first medicine school of the country was in Bahia in 1880. Yeah. Yeah. And Nina Rodriguez, he really led two or three generations of medical doctors. And also this influence really get and control the judge and the whole law school in the country for a long time. And when we talk about institutional racism and this kind of situation that we have in Brazil now, that each year we lost almost 32,000 young that is killed by again. Yeah? Three weeks ago, we had a national referendum, and the very conservative members of the Congress really manipulated the public opinion, and they don't vote. They don't vote against again. They vote against Lula. Yeah? And this is it's very important for us, because in another way, these people really want maintain this. They have 1,300 shops for games in the country, yeah? And these people control 70 members inside the Congress, yeah? And we have the result. And the victims, 78.4% of the victims, it's black young men. in the country. And I, okay.
Victims of police? Victims of police shooting? Police killing?
Police and the groups tolerated by this state. This state that is controlled by this new colonial elite. These light-skinned people that feel themselves white in Brazil, yeah? And really the white people, yeah? But this is so interesting. I'm gonna leave my paper here. I'm interested that it's now we have a campaign in the country. It's this campaign. It's React or Be Dying. And we started this campaign in March this year, and when we started this discussion inside the university and also outside, three members of the United Nations have already visited Brazil and really put the Bahia governor in a bad situation now. Because in 3 years, in 5 years, just in Salvador, the city lost between 1997 and 2001, they are 7,759 people had a violent death in Salvador. This figure represents average of 1,515 deaths per year and more than 4 fear per day. Homicide represents more than 15% of registered cases. Among these victims, 1 in 5 were children and adolescents up to the age of 19, and within this group, 61 up to the age of 18 years. Yeah. This is for each black young man that's dying in Bahia and in Brazil. They started say they lost in media 44 years for his life, and that has a real complex results inside the black community. Yeah? And I'll just stop for the questions.
Sure. I'll start with a couple questions.
Okay.
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about your activism, what you've been doing, and especially I want to know about this thing about the prisons, your ideas on the prisons.
The prisons?
Yeah.
So, for a long time in Brazil, you take a long time in Brazil, and you know, for many issues that it's really produce bad results inside the black community. And we don't talk about minorities, yeah? We talk about the half of the country, yeah? For 30 years, this black movement that we call the contemporary black movement in Brazil should talk about the human rights of the black community was a exercise, a job, a challenge just for the black movement. And recently, I mean, since the 80 years, sorry, was just only for the black female movement. And I started the black female movement when I was in the high school. I was 17, 18 years old. Yeah? In a public school that's inside the student movement, in the 80 years, we had no race discussion. Yeah? And because of I start in the black female movement close the one group inside the block was very close to Olodum. Yeah? And then I continue. But now what I make is I use my voice, and I was part of the black female and the black feminist movement. And I use my voice and the space that I have inside the universe and outside for every weekend. First, I use my face on the TV and the newspaper and all spaces of the media that I have to talk about that. Discriminalization of the black young men in the city. And the impact that the gender impact that we have inside the black community. Because we have also a situation that in each family in the low income neighborhood that you come to visit, when you talk with the mother, you talk with one, and the 1, 2, 3, 500 can tell you, I lost someone. I lost someone. It's a son, or the son of the son. Do you know? It's a really emblematic situation. And these people has no voice. They has no access to the justice in Brazil. They have no money to pay a lawyer, and we don't have a lot of people that works with them. We have CERT and the Galades in São Paulo. We have one in Salvador. We have a Gajop in Pernambuco, but not a lot of these black lawyers bureau to support the movement of the mothers. Yeah? And in general, we have in each capital of Brazil, we have SEDECAS. It's this group that supports the mothers that is they lost the children, huh? In the violent deaths. And what I'm trying to make is to visit the community and really to give, it's not, I try to share my voice with these people, and we try to know, to explain that it's not natural. It's not natural to die like this. Yeah? And we try to say, don't be quiet. Don't be quiet. Yeah? You have your rights. You can go into the court and ask for your rights. Because yeah? It's very dangerous if you denounce the police in Brazil. Yeah? I don't know here what is the situation. Eh? But I remember in 2000 I went in Texas and I was in a demonstration about Amadou Diallo. That he received 41 bullets in New York City, and people in general, it's these people has for this new liberal state has no rights. It's the case that Paulo Sérgio Pinheiro from the violence study center of USP, the University of São Paulo, say, Brazil, since 1985, we started the military periods that we have for 21 years, but we already tolerated the terror zone inside the democracy. That means it's not democracy. Yeah? Also, Brazil has this big problem with this discussion outside and inside about racial democracy, We're trying for, the Brazilian government tried for a long time to prove that they have a racial democracy. Many scholars from US traveled to Brazil since Rootlands, in 1938, from Colombia. All these people try to understand what Brazil have different. As I say, in the same way that Horaci Nogueira and Guerrero Ramos, two scholars from Brazil, said in the 50 years we have the same miserable situation that we have here. But here it's the origin. You finish you have your book, Racismo Brasileiro. And now, what is this? Professor Marcelo Paixão and the Professor Paul Omar from Santa Barbara. And Silvia Ramos, Leonardo Musumes, they published this book. It's in one part is about the they talk about this situation of this kind that Brazil is so ashamed to be prejudiced by this prejudice, and the result inside the black communities is specific for the women's, it's really very bad. And I'm trying to use my voice to improve and to support these women that has no respect of the Brazilian government. Lula tried to change. In 1996, we start with the National Human Rights Plan. And in 2000, we have the National Public Security Program to control this the impunity and this really brutality of the police inside the black community. Right? Law, it's one. But we talk about the continuation of the slavery rules inside this society. Yeah?
Can you open it up? Yes, sir.
When Lula ran for the presidency in Brazil, he made some statements about bringing together all the human elements in Brazil to a table of unity and reconciliation. Had he done anything to do that? Like a national dialogue between the descendants of Brazilian slavery and the Portuguese white Brazilian in Brazil? And what about the children that were being murdered on the streets of Rio de Janeiro, who were being hired by merchants to get rid of these children, to take them off the streets because they were panhandling the tourists? Has he done anything about that? Because I know that during when he ran for president, he did make promises to put together programs to eliminate police brutality and to bring the factions of the descendants of the black slaves of Brazil together with those who are those whites who perpetrated the slavery to try to bring about national healing in Brazil. I just want to know, did he do? Has he put any programs together to implement any of it? Or was it just something to get him elected?
So, thank you for the question. It's so much. But he started to improve them. But I think it's so difficult. We have now, for the first time in Brazil, a minister, it's Matilde Ribeiro. That is the first time that we have this position for equality to it's the minister to promote racial equality. Behind in 2001 when we have the Durban conference was until in the government of Fernando Henrique Cardoso, we start to talk about affirmative action and reparation in Brazil. I mean, not the black movement or the black scholars or black people in general, but the government, they assume that Brazil have to start a problem. And when Lula started in the government, he tried to discuss also with Luiz Eduardo Soares, this man that was the secretary of public policy, public security in Rio de Janeiro. And Luiz Eduardo Soares was the person responsible to put the different policies that we have put in the same control inside the government, and also created instruments, so mechanisms to control the action of the police by the society. Yeah? From the politics that the President Lula promises to implement for children, for example, they have this, what do you say, it's one insurance, yeah? Bolsa Escola.
Oh, it's a scholarship to keep the kid in school that goes to the family.
Yes.
It's basically money to the family, so the family doesn't have to send the kid out to work, and the kid will stay in school.
But that is not, it is not enough, because we have a, now we say the people that started violence in Brazil, this specific violence, it is urban, and that it's really, it's the worst situation of the violence. We say now the black community needed first to survive, because we fighting for have the equal opportunity, but when you have this homicide rights like you have in Brazil, maybe you have no people in the future to get the results of this struggle, and I think the President Lula he doing this exercise very good in 2003, but then this new colonial elite really so they organized themselves again and say, okay, guys, you get the political power, but we have the economic power, and we don't will leave you doing that. Yeah? They have no power inside the National Congress. Yeah? And Brazil is a presidentialism, but if you don't have the votes inside the Congress, you have nothing. Yeah? And now he's in this terrible situation, and the social politics really doesn't work. They have, of course, they have also 1 million of these scholars to children. They try to control the taxes, the level of the children. Labor, all the situation that is racist, that it's one country, that all relation it's instructed by race, yeah? And when you develop this no universal politics, you can be very close to these people. Yeah? But also now, in the National Congress, we have people that propose, Paulo Paim and Luiz Alberto, that propose the National Black Institute, that we say now it's the second emancipation of the black people. Yeah? But because all this politics to control the police, develop the social politics for children and adolescents, is that it's the politics that you can be very close to the black community. But all this thing doesn't work in Brazil. Yeah? Was only in the first year. I say was only in the first year of the Lula government. Now it's so difficult to implement the politics.
I
answer you?
Yes.
Okay. I said that we're going to collect cards. You're going to write your questions on cards, right? But we have two more questions.
Okay.
And first question is, it's a two-part question. The first part is, what percent of the police force is black? And second, if blacks are 80% of the population, why can't they vote for more favorable police leaders and police practices? That's the first question.
Thank you. This is a good question. Because during my research, in these last 3 years, I'm going to visit the people that control the police. First was the man that is the commandant in Bahia. This man is black. And the police that make this terrible work, it's also black. But who controls this police is not black. It's not black, and it's one part of my job that I try to explain, because during the all racial society like Brazil, US, South Africa, or in all this space, this country, they always use the black hands to make the dirty sums, the dirty job. Yeah? But who control? We have neighborhoods in Salvador that we can't see one black person, like Caminho das Árvores, or Alphaville, or Vila do Atlântico. They have no black. It's in this space you can understand why we have this police. Because these people who put the guns in the hands of these black people, and why these black men, when they get the hand, they have no power during his life. And when they get this gun, they say, I have the power. Yeah? And make the dirty service. It's during we have for a long time. Second, why the blacks don't vote blacks in Brazil? This is a very, very difficult question for us. Because we had Abdias Nascimento, that is a Pan-Africanist activist. Now he's 91 years old. We have Benedita da Silva, Marina Silva, Carlos Alberto Caó, that make this law against racism in the Constitution in 1988. But in Rio, now, in Rio de Janeiro, now they say, the political scientists say, when we start election now, they, how to say, dispute?
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 It's kind of a contest?
Yeah. It's 45% of the votes, it's already inside the 45%, they already discuss about race, and they know that all whites know they in this part of the voters, they need to talk about race, yeah? Because it's not more possible. But the atmosphere in my city, for example, Salvador, is this elite, really, the whole time they use the TV, the school, and the all institution to lead the black people to vote white, and they try to become us ashamed when we talk about race voter, yeah? And but I think now the black politicians really they don't stay more ashamed or in the defensive position. We really say, okay, black vote black. Yeah? And now I think in the next election we're gonna have news from Brazil, because the whole continent wait an answer from Brazil. And we can lead the position of the about race issues of all this country around Brazil. This really waits our answer. And I think it's get time.
It's very easy.
I have two more questions, and I know we're all
I'm trying to be more now.
Okay. But I'll ask this question first. You're talking about maybe a racialized, partly racialized society, maybe more like the U.S. If things continue as they are in Brazil, do you think any particular city will explode in racial unrest like Paris is now? If so, which city?
What do you say? Where is Paris?
I think como grupo urbano.
I think, thank you for the question. When I visit so these communities in the very, very poor neighborhoods, when I'm talking about low income neighborhoods in Brazil, I want to make sure that I'm talking about black neighborhoods. Yeah? That sometimes you have one white person, you can have a light skin, but really have almost everybody looks like me, like you. Yeah? In Salvador, but in South Brazil, I was very surprised. It was my first time in Porto Alegre in September, and I visited the very, very poor communities in a state that we represent only 14% of the state, and the miserable situation is also for blacks. Yeah? And I think we in Rio, in Salvador, when we have a movement like this, we really start to face this new colonial elite. Yeah? When my friends, the people that is inside the black female movement, the black movement, we say, between the left and the right party, at this moment, we really stay we don't, it's part of this or this. We became really a different thing. Yeah? I don't know if that means a black party, right? But we want to talk with our own mothers. That is so offensive for these light-skinned people in Brazil. When we say, I don't try to represent me, don't try to talk about me, I can do it myself. Right? This is so offensive for these people. And more you have these people in Brazil, inside the black community, that say, I have my ancestors, I have my history, I have my memories and heritage. Don't try to represent me. And I think we use it the same way in the next election in Brazil. Yeah? Politicians like Luiz Alberto, Jurema Batista, all these people, Jurema is a woman, a black female from Rio de Janeiro, and Paulo Paim from Rio Grande do Sul, he's a senator. All these people, it's really, we don't take a long time to have really conflict, right? Because these people don't want conflict. And the racial democracy in Brazil, they never want conflict. They stay like that. And I think we really, I'm not afraid. I'm very happy because I'm 36 years and I'm the first person in my family inside the university. And my generation really come to change. Outside the university, people that has no access, people that has no eating for 3 times in the day, but stay in all speech, in the hip hop movement, in the candomblé house. When I get so, when we visit a candomblé house, it's a Afro-Brazilian religion. People say, no, they don't control my mind anymore. This is, I'm very hopeful. Because also, it's my exercise that I made here with Angela Davis or in Berkeley. When I try, I start to study English because when I make contact with people outside my country, I don't want that someone translate for me. Yeah? It's a politic position. I know my English is so, but I say no. I have to make this exercise too. Yeah? And I'm very happy because many people here is this really reception to talk about Brazil, and we try to make a network between Seafro, Santa Barbara, and here in Berkeley. So, and we really try to continue, right, to support this black female and black young people in the low-income neighborhood that every day wake up and say, okay, we have to continue. Right?
We have one last question. First of all, they said we thought your presentation was important and interesting. Many of us would agree. I'll ask your second question first. Where can you get your published papers? Your papers, are they published or will we find it?
Oh, I don't know. a friend, she's in the New York University. She invited me to present that, and Professor Paul Ma, he made the translation. I say thank you for Paul Ma because he made this very good work. And I don't know.
So if you have anything, you can leave it here. Maybe you can use the Bunche Center as a point.
Yeah.
We can circulate.
Because I think it's very interesting because your job, the job of Mark Soil and many people, yeah? We don't work for to live in the
library.
In the library, yeah? Our work, I'm very happy when a young man or a young lady in Salvador, we published this book. It's they call plural school. The divorce, it's in the classrooms. It's about the new law that was the first law that Lula approved in his government. It's to teach the African and the Afro-Brazilian history in the all level of school in Brazil. Yeah? And I wrote an article here, and all my friends, Professor Wanda Salvajet, she asked me to give you a blessing. Né? And Professor Wanda Salvajet, that was the founder of SEAFRA, when these people so meet me on the street and say, oh, now I'm going because I read this article, or I see you in the newspaper, né? I'm very happy because we can use our title, all of you. We can use our power at the universe to be outside the universe because the work that we make in the, how to say it, this extensão at the universe.
Station.
In general, people pay attention only for teaching and research, but the extension, the work with the community in SEAFRA for 10 years, we received almost 5,000 students from Afro Blocos, from Candomblé House, from really grassroots organization. And these people, we can use our title. Title is not to be so proud or selfish. Eh? It's really to give it for, and also everything that we write, it's to put the people together like we stay here now. Eh? And it's okay.
Sure. Location. Oh. So maybe you can send this.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna live here.
Okay.
Yeah, I brought soap, and I have this. It's the campaign. Oops. It's me. Sorry, Edward. It's the campaign that we're doing about the exploitation of the children in the domestic labor, and I brought soap. 5, 6, I also want to give for you, okay? Because now we have a campaign in SEAFRA we are really in a very difficult situation, but we want to share what we're doing with people that really it's friendly and has energy to continue, yeah? This is so.
Okay, let me ask them the last question. How do you interpret the recent defeat of the national referendum on gun control? It seemed like the population was instilled with a sense of fear. I heard comments justifying a no vote on gun control, such as police have guns. This is not a democratic state. We need guns to protect ourselves. It seems that this type of thinking, especially among poor and black populations in urban areas, is really echoing the failure of the new liberal state that you refer to scare the population. But doesn't it also reflect the difficulty of reducing violence in an escalating police state?
would say, I think people in Brazil voted many stuff in this referendum. Vote so was not a vote against. If they it's true. If they have secured, they don't feel themselves that they need again. Yeah? But we know nobody's secured to this again. Yeah? It's my opinion. And I think people really have fear also from the police. Because only the secured private groups, company, can now buy again the police and people that lives in the land. Yeah? So in Brazil now, we have 17 million gangs inside the country. Yeah? 17 million. They say in the new style from Viva Rio, yeah? And 80% of this gang was produced in Brazil. Only 20% come from outside, and the part was no legal. Come from the different boards that Brazil have, with Paraguay, all just countries here. For us, that it's in the human rights of black, that's different way of human rights, because when you talk about human rights in Brazil, we have two groups. One group that believe human rights, so you don't talk about gender, race, sexuality, orientation, everything. Oh, thank you. And when we talk about human rights, we talk about human rights in this intersection, gender, race, class, generation, sexual orientation, people that has handicaps, all these issues, because without that it's not possible to talk about human rights, yeah? And I think it's so difficult for us. We decide vote to control the gangs, yeah? We decide in the movement, because the result inside the black community is really terrible. We lost a lot of people, and maybe we have different opinions, but we decide to vote to control the trade of gangs, yeah? Because for us, the result is really terrible. And we have the numbers here. The United Nations, we have all these, maybe then we can look. So every day you have this image around the country. Inside you have more pictures. It's Heroin, it's the national black newspaper. And here it's the UNESCO study. That get the number from 1979 until 2003. And the short is that during this time we lost 550,000 people. Yeah? And inside this group, 205,000 was young people in the age between 15 to 24. Yeah? It's really a war. Yeah? And for us, it's only by gang side to the control, yeah? Because when you we see the rights here, and also in Brazil, we have the level of homicide. It's more height than in the international area that you have open conflicts like Israel. Yeah? Brazil, it's in the second position. They lost only for Venezuela. Yeah? They're showing this resource here. And this year, the UNICEF chose the same issues to work in the next 5 years in Brazil. It's really a very serious problem. Yeah? And at the universe, I decided that in general, people just talk about São Paulo outside, especially, right? About São Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. And sometimes about Recife or Brasília, the capital. I decided to take this case of Salvador, because I want to give it the visibility for this problem from this city that the whole time this new colonial elite, so they party and they seem to celebrate the black heritage. They use the image of the black people in the International Travel Bureau to show in Brazil, but when you go in Brazil, they have no blacks in the air company, they have no blacks in the banks, no blacks. And it's one answer for this violent atmosphere. Yeah? It's one answer. Yeah? It's race and employment. But it's not only this. It's also this history of how to eliminate the other. That don't want to assimilate the whiteness. Yeah? This is so... Yeah, I'm so tired.
So
thank you.